Hello and welcome to Holy Impact Ministries Bible Study Night, a holyimpactministries.com production. I'm Pastor Scott Blaine. God bless you and thank you for sharing your time with us here today on our Wednesday night Bible studies. We are actually moving into the 11th chapter of the book of Romans. Now, we've been talking about this for quite some time. The 11th chapter of Romans is the actual heartbeat, the meat and potatoes, if you will, of the book of Romans, and especially if you are confused about who you are as a Christian or where the Israelites fit in or who the Jews are or and all of these kinds of things. Paul very nicely and very neatly and very eloquently puts all of the pieces of the puzzle together here in the book of Romans, and this is extremely important for us to know and to understand. Now, with that being said, if you are brand new and you've never seen anything from us at holyimpactministries.com, we urge you to start at Romans chapter 1. There is a lot of information here that will not be given, that has already been given in previous Bible studies throughout the previous chapters. So we don't want you to miss anything. We want you to have the whole picture. But for time's sake, we certainly can't go back and do all of those first 10 chapters for the sake of those folks that are just coming into the 11th chapter right now. So please, we urge you to look at those so that you can pick up that information, know and understand what we're talking about in the 11th chapter a little bit better. With that being said, if you're prepared to move along, and if you've been with us throughout the first 10 chapters, we are now going to move into the 11th chapter of Romans, and I am extremely excited about this chapter because this chapter of Romans, as I said, is just absolutely so important. We're going to learn so many things within this chapter of Romans. I think that you will agree with me when I say that this really is the bedrock of what Paul was trying to teach and preach in the book of Romans. Now, so far we've seen in the book of Romans, we've seen that Paul does not ever preach against the law of God, ever. He never preaches against the Sabbaths or the feast days or any of God's laws at all. Not against circumcision, not against any of it. And for those of you who do not know this, and those of you who believe that Paul does preach against the laws of God, once again, we urge you to start at the beginning at Romans 1 and follow us down through the first 10 chapters to this point. So we know that Paul was very vehemently concerned about the Israelites in the 9th and 10th chapters, and he was very sorrowful that they did not come to the truth of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. So many of the Jews had snubbed their nose and turned away and just would not come, and the other Pharisees and the scribes and others that were sitting in his audience were continuing to preach the works of the law. And for many Christians, it's very difficult for many Christians today that are coming out of today's modern day version of Christianity to know and to understand that Paul was always preaching for God's laws and not against them. And we're going to even show you that here in the 11th chapter of Romans as well. It is extremely important. It is monumental that you understand that fact before you move on, or at least have that in your hearing before we move on, especially if you are new to this particular study of the book of Romans. Now, what I'd like to do is I'd like to just go ahead and jump right into it. We've got a lot of ground that I want to cover here and some subsequent scriptures that all tie in nicely and neatly with what Paul is saying here, and I want to bring those to your attention as we move along. So let's go ahead and start. I'm going to move us over to eastward here, where we can actually read this together so we don't get lost, and so there's no doubt that we are reading from the Word of God. We will be reading from the English Standard Version of the Bible today. Okay, so let's begin at Romans 11 and 1. He says this, "I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means, Paul says. For I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin." Remember, we spoke about Paul being a Pharisee. He is a Pharisee himself. He was from the tribe of Benjamin, which was the other tribe that was with the tribe of Judah when the two kingdoms split. You had the northern kingdom with 10 tribes up top, and then you had Judah and some Benjamites mixed in the southern kingdom down below. And we know that Paul indeed was a Benjamite, and again, he was a Pharisee. Knowing the Torah very well, even having committed it to memory in order that he could sit at the feet of Gamaliel. So we know these things about Paul. He's an extremely highly educated man. He comes from Tarsus, which was the academic capital of the world at that time. He knew and was very versed in the teachings of Aristotle and Plato and Socrates and these types of things. And he could speak at least three languages that we know of. So Paul was an extremely intelligent man, and again, is a Benjamite. And he continues on. He says, God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. Do you not know that the scripture says what the scripture says of Elijah, how he appeals to God against Israel? And he goes into how Elijah at one point in time, because he was condemning Israel, because Israel had killed all of the prophets and they were trying to kill Elijah himself. So he continues on. He says, God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. Now, let's just stop right there for a moment. How many modern day Christians today believe that God has forsaken the Israelites and the Jews, and the new Gentile church has taken over and replaced those terrible Jews that hung Jesus on the cross? How many times have we heard this? I want to start from the beginning again, from the first sentence, and I just want us to know and understand that that is a false doctrine and nothing more than man-made garbage. When people tell you that God has completely forgotten about his Israelite people, my friends, we need to know and understand biblically that the truth of the fact of the matter is that God never chose any other people on the face of the earth to be his people other than the Israelites. They are the only people who are called throughout the whole Bible, whether you're reading the Torah or the Brit Hadashah, the New Testament. They are always spoken of as God's people. Now let's start just real quick. Let's go back to the beginning. He says, I asked then, has God rejected his people? Paul says, by no means, he says, for I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. Do you not know what the scripture says of Elijah, how he appeals to God against Israel? Lord, they have killed your prophets. They have demolished your altars. And I alone am left, and they seek my life. But what is God's reply to him? I have kept myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to Baal. Now, we need to stop here, and we need to just remember, if you've never read the book and you've never heard and understood the story of Elijah, or you've never read the Old Testament, we need to know and understand. Remember, there was this big duel between Elijah and the god of Baal. The Israelites were actually worshiping the god Baal. And Elijah came to them and he said, you know what, let's sacrifice a bull and let's get the wood together. And he says, you make a pile over there, I'll make a pile over here. And your god can start your fire and my god will start my fire, right? And what happened? He told the Israelites that were following Baal, he said, go ahead, have your god start his fire, he can go first. And they did everything that they possibly could. They prayed to their God, and they were cutting themselves, and they were doing all of these different things, and they could not get their God to start the fire. So Elijah starts laughing at them and telling them, well, you know, where is your God? Is he relieving himself somewhere, or where is your God at? And this made the Israelites extremely mad. So Elijah turns to his stack of wood, and he instructs the Israelites to pour water all over his wood. And he does this. They do this. And they pour water all over his wood. And a second time, he tells them, pour some more water on the wood. Make sure it's good and wet. A third time, he tells them, pour more water on there. And at this point in time, you now have a little creek or a little basin of water that's gathering up around the wood. And of course, Elijah prays to the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and fire comes down from the sky and burns up every bit of that wet wood and licks up every bit, every drop of water that was surrounding it as well. Excuse me. So we can know and we can understand. And then what did they do? They chased Elijah, had to run from the king to stay alive. And back into the wilderness he went. Even then they would not believe, and even then they would not stop worshiping Baal. So this is exactly what Paul is talking about. And Elijah pled with Yahweh, God the Father. He said, Lord, they've killed your prophets. They've even demolished your altars. And he says, I alone am left, and they even seek to kill me. So what did God say? He said to them, he says, I have kept for myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to Baal. Okay, so God kept himself a remnant of the Israelites. So let's continue on here in the red. It says, so too, at the present time, there is a remnant chosen by grace. Do we see that in 11:5? Romans 11:5. There is, at this present time, there is a remnant chosen by God's grace. Okay, he says, but if it is by grace, it is no longer on the basis of works. Otherwise, grace would no longer be grace. Now, what is he saying here? It sure kind of sounds like, and a lot of people will throw this up to us and say, well, see, you're not saved by works, so the law is done away with. Well, I might want to bring to your attention that there's nothing in Romans 11:6 anywhere that says that God's laws are done away with. It simply says, but if it is by grace, it is no longer on the basis of works. Otherwise, grace would no longer be grace. Now, what is works? And we've been through this in previous chapters of the book of Romans. Works is work. It's something that you don't want to do, but you have to do. That's what work is. Okay? Now, what does the Bible say the definition of the love of God is? The Bible says, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. So keeping his commandments are not burdensome for us. They are not, then therefore they are not work. His laws, his commandments, his precepts, his moedim, his appointments, his Sabbaths are written in our hearts. And this is why we keep them. What was the new covenant that was written about in Jeremiah 31:31? It was that God would write his laws in the hearts of his people. That's what the whole new covenant was all about. That's what Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, came to die for. He died for the penalty of sin, the penalty of breaking the law. That's what he died for, to do away with that penalty, the law of sin and death. He did not come, as he said in Matthew 5:17, he did not come to do away with the law or to abolish the law. And just like he says in Matthew 5:17, he said, heaven and earth will pass away before the dotting of an I or the crossing of a T passes away from God's law. And we can know that. He said that with his own breath. It's red letter words, my friends. Matthew 5:17, you can read that for yourselves. So what Paul is saying here is that it's no longer on the basis of works, okay? Why do we keep the laws of God? Why do we keep the Sabbath? Why do we celebrate the Passover and the feast days? Why do we do this? It's understood that we do not keep the laws of God to be saved, to earn anything, to earn our way into heaven. We don't keep the laws of God to be saved. We keep the laws of God because we are saved. You see, we know and we understand that we have that hope of salvation. It has been planted, that seed has been planted in our hearts. We have the hope of that salvation right now. And if we have that Holy Spirit that our own Messiah said, he said, you must be baptized by both the water and the Spirit, or you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. So if you have the Spirit, what does God say? He says very clearly, he says, for this is the love of God, that we keep God's commandments and they are not burdensome to us. If you have the Holy Spirit of God, you're not keeping the laws of God to earn anything or to make any points. You're keeping the laws of God out of the love of God that you have for God in your heart. There is a huge difference, my friends, between works and the love of God. Okay? So I want us to know and understand that. Pardon me, that was on my end, if you guys, just in case you guys were wondering. Okay, so he says, but if it is by grace, the grace of God, it no longer is on the basis of works. And that's what the Pharisees were always trying to do. They were trying to keep the law by works. If they did something, they earned something, and they were trying to earn their way into heaven. And Yahweh God said, no. It's never been like that, and it certainly isn't like that now. I just got done sending my only begotten Son to die on a tree for your sins, so that your sins could be forgiven, so that you would no longer have to sacrifice animals. He was the Passover lamb. And we need to know and understand that he was the propitiation for all sin, all of the sins of the world. And we need to know and understand these things. We also need to understand that he was a Jew. He came from the house of David and from the tribe of Judah. So we can know and understand that our Messiah was a Jew, and it is the blood of a Jew that covers the transgressions of the whole world. So we need to know this. And he did not die to abolish the law. He came to die to abolish the penalty for transgressing the law. And we've been through that in these subsequent or these previous chapters. So once again, to prove that out, and we're going to prove some of that to you as we go here. But I just want you to know and understand where we're coming from, what we're talking about, what Paul is saying here. So he's saying very clearly that God said, even back in Elijah's time, he kept a remnant of the Israelite people for himself. And he's saying, Paul says, even at this present time, a remnant has been chosen by the grace of God. And he says, there's no works involved in this. This is by the grace of God. He has chosen to have grace on who he has chosen to have grace on. So you can't earn your way in. And that's all he's saying. He's not saying that the law is abolished or that we don't have to obey any of his laws or commandments or his Sabbaths or anything else. He's not saying any of that is done away with. He's simply saying that you cannot get there by works, by thinking that you're going to earn your way in. Doesn't work that way. Okay. He says, what then? He says, Israel failed to obtain what it was seeking. The elect obtained it, but the rest were hardened. As it is written, God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes that would not see and ears that would not hear down to this very day. And David says, let their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block and a retribution for them. Let their eyes be darkened so that they cannot see and bend their backs forever. So I ask, did they stumble in order that they may fall? He says, by no means. And again, he's still talking about the Israelites. Okay, and he's talking about the northern kingdom that God divorced. He gave them a certificate of divorce. And he says, you are no longer my people. And he sent them and dispersed them into the four corners of the earth. They were also known as the lost sheep of Israel. Okay, so this is who he's talking about. He's talking about these that have stumbled. Okay, and so he goes on and he says, so I asked, did they stumble in order that they might fall? He says, by no means. Rather, he says, through their trespass, salvation has come to the Gentiles so as to make Israel jealous. Okay? So Paul is really wrapping it all together here. He's trying to tell us, through the trespass of Israel, the northern kingdom, God has opened up a path for the Gentiles to come onto him, to come forward, to come to him. Okay? So he's now, there is grace also for the Gentiles because of their trespass. Now listen to what he says. Let's read that again. He says, rather, through their trespass, the Israelites' trespass, salvation has come to the Gentiles so as to make Israel jealous. That's why salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel jealous. Now listen to how he works this all out. Now if their trespass, the Israelites' trespass, means riches for the world, and if their failure means riches for the Gentiles, how much more will their full inclusion mean? You see, God has a plan to bring them back. It is to make them jealous and to make them come back. Our Jewish brothers and sisters and those people who are still out there who do not believe in Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, He has given us salvation to make them jealous. And my friends, it is working even to today. There are more Jewish people that are now coming to the realization that Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, is their Savior. Once they come out of the lies of Catholicism and the Catholic Church, and because one of the reasons that the Jewish people could not come to Christianity was because they knew all of these feast days, these holidays, these Sabbaths, and all of these things that the modern day version of Christianity keeps. They knew that these were not of God. They didn't have anything to do with God, and they knew that. They knew the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Their forefathers walked with him. They wrote these things down. They kept excellent records. They knew that Sunday is not the Sabbath, and they knew that full well. They knew that Jesus' birthday, even Jesus, they knew his birthday was not on December 25th. They knew he did not die on Good Friday. They knew they kept good records, even those Jews who do not believe in Yeshua as their Messiah believed that he was a prophet. And they know when he died, and they know the story of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, and they know that what is being spun by Catholicism in today's Protestant churches, which are following Catholicism, they know that that's a lie. But when they learn the truth of Christianity, and they know and they understand who, then they know and understand who the Messiah was. They can go back in the Torah and read and see the prophetical writings that pointed directly to him. He is all through the Torah from the beginning of Genesis. He was the Word that hovered over the waters with Yahweh God the Father. He was the Word made flesh that came down to walk among men. And we know that from the book of John. So once they read and they read into the true Christianity, the true version of Christianity, which is that God's laws were never done away with. Yeshua even said, "I didn't come to abolish the laws," in Matthew 5:17. He says, "Until heaven and earth pass away, the laws are not going to be taken away. I didn't come to change anything." He said, he told us that. He says, "I came to fulfill them. I came to do them. I didn't come to abolish them." Matthew 5:17, red letter words, he even says to himself. So we can know this, and we can understand this. So he says, Israel failed to obtain what it was seeking. He says, the elect obtained it, but the rest were hardened, as it is written. God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes that would not see and ears that would not hear, down to this very day. And even David says, let their table become a snare, a trap, a stumbling block, a retribution for them. Let their eyes be darkened so they cannot see and bend their backs forever. Talking about these Israelites up in the northern kingdom and these people that just absolutely continue to worship these pagan gods and things. He says, so I ask, he says, did they stumble, Paul says, that they might fall? He says, by no means, rather through their trespass, salvation has come to the Gentiles so as to make Israel jealous, okay? So he's now offering his salvation to the Gentiles to make Israel jealous. Now, watch how God puts all this together. Now, watch how he includes all people. Paul tells us these deepest secrets in this chapter, right here, the chapter of Romans. He says, now, if their trespass means riches for the world, and if their failure means riches for the Gentiles, how much more will their full inclusion mean? He says, now, I'm speaking to you Gentiles. Inasmuch then as I am an apostle to the Gentiles, I magnify my ministry in order somehow to make my fellow Jews jealous and thus save some of them. Okay? So once again, this is exactly what Paul was sent to do, is to make the Jews and the Israelites jealous so that he can save some of them. Okay? Now listen to this, Romans 11:15. For if their rejection means the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance mean but life from the dead? Okay? Now, I don't want to go too far here. I want us to understand, for those of you who do not understand I want you to understand the who the olive tree is before we get too far here, okay? Because Paul is going to, right now, pretty soon, in the next couple of sentences, he's going to start talking about an olive tree. So before we get too deep into this, I want you to know and I want you to understand that the Israelites are the olive tree. No one else is the olive tree. There is nothing else that is the olive tree. It is the Israelites. How do we know this? Well, let's go to, I want to take you over very quickly to Jeremiah. Okay. And we're going to go to 11:16. And what does it say? And this is in the Torah, Jeremiah 11:16. The Lord once called you a green olive tree, beautiful with good fruit. But with the roar of a great tempest, he will set fire to it, and its branches will be consumed. Again, because they continuously kept whoring after other gods. Okay? Israel was always known as the bride of God, and God was her husband. And that's why it tells us very clearly that they were divorced. God divorced the northern kingdom of Israel. He says, I have given you a certificate of divorce. Now, by Jewish law, according to Jewish law, if a woman is adulterous, okay, and the husband divorces her, there's no way for that woman to come back. She cannot, by law, she cannot come back. So no one could figure out how in the world the Israelites were ever going to be rejoined with their groom. How was the bride going to be joined back to her groom? No one had any idea how this was even possible anymore. Okay? So again, the Israelites were dispersed into the four corners of the world. Now, Judah also was taken into bondage, but Judah came back. And this is where we get into Antiochus Epiphanes and Alexander the Great and all of that kind of stuff. That's what Hanukkah is all about. If you don't know anything about Hanukkah, this is when they went and fought and got the temple back. Antiochus Epiphanes persecuted the Jews and slaughtered them and started burning pigs and unclean animals on the altar of God. And this is about what Hanukkah is all about. And they got the Maccabees went and fought, got the temple back, and that's why there was a temple for Yeshua to walk in when he came. So, but that's another whole story. And I don't want to get too much into that, but I do want us to understand what he says. He says, the Lord once called you a green olive tree, beautiful with good fruit. Okay? Now, I also want to take us over to Ezekiel 37:16. Let's see here, Ezekiel 37:16. Now, Ezekiel 37:16. Okay. Now, I want you to listen to this. We're going to read down to the 28th chapter. And this is important for you to understand. If you're going to understand the book of Romans and you're going to understand this 11th chapter, you got to understand who the Israelites are. And you got to know that they are the olive tree. And what's going on with this olive tree? Well, let's listen to what he says. You see, it was prophesied in Ezekiel that the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom would come back together. And here is that prophecy, and I want you to hear it. Okay? Ezekiel 37:16, Son of man, take a stick and write on it for Judah and the people of Israel associated with him. Then take another stick and write on it for Joseph, the stick of Ephraim, and all the house of Israel associated with him. Okay, so he's telling him, look, he says, get a stick and write Judah's name on one and Ephraim, or the house of Israel, on the other stick. He's got two sticks. Now, what's he going to do with these two sticks? Listen, he says, and join them one to another into one stick. He's going to put the kingdom of Israel back together again. Okay? So there no longer will be a northern kingdom and a southern kingdom. Let's read that again. He says, take a stick and write on it for Judah and the people of Israel associated with them. Then take another stick and write on it for Joseph, the stick of Ephraim, and all the house of Israel associated with him. And join them one to another into one stick, that they may become one in your hand. And when your people say to you, will you not tell us what you mean by these? Say to them, thus says the Lord your God, Behold, listen to this now. I am about to take the stick of Joseph that is in the land of Ephraim. He's talking about the Israelites and the tribes of Israel, okay, associated with him. And I'm going to join it with the stick of Judah, the southern kingdom, and make them one stick that they may be in my hand. He's going to take those two sticks and make them one stick, one nation they will become again. He says, when the sticks on which you write are in your hand before their eyes, then say to them, thus says the Lord your God, behold, I will take the people of Israel from the nations among which they have gone, and will gather them from all around and bring them into their own land. Now, what's he talking about here? He's talking about the northern kingdom that he divorced and scattered off into all the nations of the earth. He's saying, I'm going to bring them back. I'm going to bring them back into their own land. Let's read that again. Thus says the Lord God, behold, I will take the people of Israel from the nations among which they have gone, okay, when he scattered them out, and will gather them from all around, and I'll bring them back to their own land. And I will make them one nation in the land on the mountains of Israel, and one king shall be king over them all. And they shall be no longer two nations and no longer divided into two kingdoms. So this is all about Yahweh God telling the Israelites that he is going to bring them back and make the two sticks one stick. Now, oftentimes you'll hear this, the prophecy of the two sticks. This is what this is. It says, they in Ezekiel 37:23, it says, they shall not defile themselves anymore with their idols and with their detestable things, or with any of their transgressions. But I will save them from all their backslidings in which they have sinned. Now, who does that? Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. He would, again, this is a shadow, this is a prophecy of Jesus coming. He says, I will save them from all their backslidings in which they have sinned, and will cleanse them, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God. My servant David, who is he talking about here? He's talking about Yeshua, Jesus, who was a descendant of David. He says, my servant David shall be king over them, and they shall all have one shepherd. They shall walk in my rules and be careful to obey my statutes. They shall dwell in the land that I gave to my servant Jacob, where your fathers lived. They and their children and their children's children shall dwell there how long? Forever. And David, my servant, shall be their prince forever. I will make a covenant of peace with them. So David will reign over, once again, over the people. He says, I will make a covenant of peace with them. It shall be an everlasting covenant with them, and I will set them in their land and multiply them, and will set my sanctuary in their midst forever. Now listen to this, for anybody who thinks that the Gentile church has replaced the Israelites, hear this from Ezekiel 37:27-28. He says, my dwelling place shall be with them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Then the nations will know that I am the Lord who sanctifies Israel when my sanctuary is in their midst forevermore. Forevermore. When my sanctuary is in their midst forever. Okay? There is no getting rid of the Israelites. There is no divorcing them to the point to where they're not coming back. Yeshua HaMashiach came as the Passover lamb, as the propitiation for their sins. And when they are baptized, okay, the bride is then buried dead in the ground with Yeshua. That's what baptism is. You go under the water. You are raised up in newness and the newness of life. The bride becomes resurrected and is a new bride and can now come back to her husband. This is the only way that an Israelite can come back, is through faith in the Messiah. You see, the Israelites need the Messiah, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, to come back to God, and the Gentile needs Jesus Christ to come to him in the first place. Okay? So this is how it all fits together. And what does this say? God says very clearly, he says, then the nations will know that I am the Lord who sanctifies Israel. The nations of the world will know when my sanctuary is in their midst forever. Forever. Okay? So let's know and understand that Paul knows full well what he's talking about in the book of Romans. Let's go back now and let's look at the book of Romans. Hopefully that will kind of put things in the proper perspective for you. You know what what God said he was going to do. And why did our Messiah come back? What did he come for? He says very clearly, he says, I came back for the lost sheep of Israel. That's what he came back for. Okay? And that comes right directly from our Messiah's own tongue, his own breath, his own words. I came for the lost sheep of Israel. Okay? So, very good. I want us to know this, and I want us to understand this. God never got rid of the Israelites. Just like Paul tells us in Romans 11:5, so too at the present time there is a remnant of the Israelites chosen by grace. Okay? Rather, through their trespass, he's talking about the Israelites, he says, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel jealous. Now, if their trespass means riches for the world and their failure means riches for the Gentiles, how much more will their full inclusion mean? Because through the Israelites, we were saved. It was through their trespass was part of the reason that we were saved, is what Paul is trying to tell us here. Now, listen to this. He says, Now I am speaking to you Gentiles, inasmuch then as I am an apostle to the Gentiles. I magnify my ministry in order somehow to make my fellow Jews jealous and to save some of them. For if their rejection means the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance mean but life from the dead? Now listen, this is where he starts getting into Romans 11:16. This is where he starts getting into this olive tree. Okay, and the olive tree. Who's the olive tree? We already know who the olive tree is. Jeremiah 11:16. The olive tree is the Israelites. Okay? This is what he said. He says, if the dough offered as first fruits is holy, so is the lump. Okay, now who's holy? Is there anyone ever that walked on the earth that is holy? No one other than Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. He is the only one holy. He says this. He continues on. He says, where was I here? Romans 11:16. He says, if the dough offered as first fruits, the sacrificial lamb, who was the first fruit? That was Yeshua, Jesus Christ. He says, if that's holy, so is the whole lump. And if the root is holy, so are the branches. Who's the root? It is the Messiah. It is Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. Who are the branches? The Israelites. It is God's chosen people, the only people he ever chose throughout the whole Bible. He never chose anyone else but the Israelites. He did not choose the Americans or the Italians or the Chinese or the Japanese or the Mexicans or the Canadians or the Pakistanis or the Turks. He didn't choose anybody. He didn't choose England. He didn't choose anybody. He chose the Israelites. He said, these are my people. These are the chosen. Okay? So, who is the root? It is Yeshua, the only one that is holy. And through him, because he is holy, the branches also, who are the Israelites, are holy. Okay, let's continue on. He says, but if some of the branches were broken off, okay, he's talking about some of those Israelites, okay, they were broken off. Why? Because of their disbelief in Yeshua HaMashiach. They were broken off. He says, but if some of the branches were broken off, and you, although a wild olive shoot, he's talking about Gentiles now, he said, if you were grafted in among the others and now share in the nourishing root of the olive tree, he says, do not be arrogant towards the branches, Gentile. He's saying, you Gentile, don't be arrogant about these Israelites. Okay? He says, if you are, in Romans 11:18, he says, if you are, he says, remember, it is not you who support the root, but the root that supports you. Yeshua Jesus was what? A Jew, right? He was an Israelite, okay? We've got to know this, and we've got to grasp this, and we've got to get it in our mind and in our heart so that we know what the truth is, and not let these blind guides, these whitewashed tombs, these brood of viper, these twofold children of hell tell us anything different. This is the truth, my friends. Paul is laying it out right here for us. So let's read it again. I want this to stick with you. He said, but if some of the branches were broken off, those Israelites, okay, because they didn't believe in the Messiah, okay? So if some of the branches were broken off, and you, although a live olive shoot, you Gentile, were grafted in among the others and now share in the nourishing root of the olive tree, don't be arrogant towards the branches, because if you are, remember, he says, it is not you that support the root, but the root that supports you. Then you will say, branches were broken off so that I might be grafted in. And this is true. They were broken off, talking about the Israelites. They were broken off. Why? Because of their unbelief. Romans 11:20. He says, that's true. They were broken off because of their unbelief. But you stand fast through what? Through faith. So do not become proud, but fear. Now, why should we not become proud, but fear? Because we weren't there first. We were not the chosen people. We are being grafted in. And it is not us that supports the branches. It's the root that supports us. Okay? Paul continues. For if God did not spare the natural branches, neither will he spare you. If he didn't spare them, the Israelites, he's not going to spare you either. He says, note then the kindness and the severity of God. Severity towards those who have fallen, but God's kindness to you, provided you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you too will be cut off. There you have it, my friends, the once saved, always saved doctrine of men, thrown to the ground. Absolutely thrown to the ground. Done. Dead. Put a fork in it. It's done. There is no such thing as once saved, always saved. And this right there, that's it. It puts the dagger right through the heart of that man-made false doctrine of demons, my friends. Very clearly, note then the kindness and the severity of God, severity towards those who have fallen, but God's kindness to you, provided you continue in his kindness, otherwise you too will be cut off. Okay, so let's get that. Let's understand that. Don't let them lie to you. I'm telling you right now, there's no difference between the scribes and the Pharisees of Yeshua's time and the pastors and the priests of today's time. They are the same. They're doing exactly the same thing. They are lying to you, and you need to know and understand through the Word of God and through His instruction, how not to be deceived. Just read this text for yourself. Know the story. Understand the prophecy of the two sticks of Israel, where God said, I am going to bring them back, and I am going to make the two sticks, the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom, one stick. And understand who the olive tree is. Okay? And we Gentiles were offered salvation to make the Israelites jealous so that they would come back. Okay, he's using us to draw them in, just like he used them to draw us to him. You see? It's just absolutely genius when you look at how God gets the whole world to come together and how he makes us one tree, one stick, all of us. Okay, let's continue on. So let's take this out again. So you two will be cut off. Romans 11:23. Let's continue. And even they, if they do not continue in their unbelief, he's talking about the Israelites and the Jews. He says, even they, if they do not continue in their unbelief, will be grafted in. For God has the power to graft them in again. Okay? For if you, Gentile, he's talking to Gentiles now, he says, for if you were cut from what is by nature a wild olive tree and grafted contrary to nature into a cultivated olive tree, how much more will these natural branches be grafted back into their own olive tree? So how much easier will it be for those Israelites who were part of the original tree to be grafted back in? Of course, it'll be much easier for them because they already have the laws. They already had the precepts. They already have the appointments, the Moedim. They already have this, okay? So it's going to be even that much easier for them to be grafted back in. He says this in Romans 11:25. Lest you be wise in your own sight, I do not want you to be unaware of this mystery, brothers. A partial hardening has come upon Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And my friends, we are looking today at the fullness of the Gentiles coming in. How do we know that? Because of the thousands, hundreds and hundreds of thousands, if not even into the millions, of Jewish messianics that there are now today. Messianic Jewish people. What is messianic? What's a messianic Jew? That is someone who understands who their Messiah is. They accept Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, as their Messiah. And you see that they are growing by leaps and bounds. What does that tell you? It tells you that the fullness of the Gentiles is beginning to come in, and it's about to close, okay? So what does he say? It says a partial hardening has come upon Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And we see that happening today. More and more Jews are now coming to the Messiah, to know and understand who their Messiah is. They're looking past Catholicism and past the Protestant churches and past all of the fake man-made rituals and garbage and trash of Christmas and Easter and Advent and Lent and Easter bunnies and magical elves and flying reindeer. They're getting past that, and they're realizing that was all made up by men. Yeshua never said anything about keeping any of that, ever, ever, anywhere in the Bible. He never said anything about that. Once they realize that, once they realize that all of that is trash, then they look what the Messiah really did say. He says, I didn't come to abolish the law. He said, I didn't come to abolish it, not even the crossing of a T, the dotting of an I, until heaven and earth pass away, he said. So when the Jewish people see this, and they look at this and they really read the Bible, what the Bible says, instead of listening to some Catholic guy or some poor lost soul from the Protestant church who's following after the Catholics, saying that he doesn't have anything to do with the Catholic, but still following after all of their laws. I mean, it's mind-boggling for the Jew to look at what Jesus really did say and to know that all of this going on in the Catholic church and all of this going on in modern-day Christianity that they got from the Catholic church is just nothing but smoke and mirrors. It's a lie created by our adversary to keep them from coming to their Messiah. Once they realize that he was absolutely a Jew, just like he said he was, he came and they can look back and trace his lineage back to the house of David and the tribe of Judah. They know who he was. All of the scripture of the Torah point directly to him. Everything from Genesis all the way on up, from the Exodus, the blood above the door, post, everything, the way the temple was laid out, everything points to the Messiah, everything. Once they know the truth, they come running back in droves. And once they have someone that has the knowledge to teach them the truth and to show them, look, this is what's written. You need to read this New Testament, this Brit Hadashah. You need to read what he said. Don't listen to them, what they're saying. Don't listen to what they're doing. Don't watch them. Watch the Bible. Look what he said. Look what's in this Brit Hadashah, this New Testament. And when they study it, once they get it, they come back in droves, and they are coming back. And it is amazing how many Messianic Jews there are now. And many of the Christian people, because they have smartphones and laptops and all of these other kind of things, they start realizing that all of this is nothing. This modern day version of Christianity is nothing but a lie. And they start going back to the Jews, and the Jews start running back to the Gentile. We're running into each other, and we are becoming the tree that we were always meant to be. So Jew and Gentile now having no problem being together. We know we're supposed to be together. God used the misconduct of the Israelites in order to give us salvation. And he used our salvation to make them jealous, you see. So he's actually getting us to run towards each other and to cleave to one another. That's what Paul is saying in the 11th chapter of Romans. Let's continue. This is just amazing and astounding how people can get this wrong, and because they don't read the first half of the book, and this is why they don't understand. More men with more degrees than a thermometer, and I'm talking about degree after degree after degree after degree in hermeneutics and theology and exegesis and all of these different things, lost. Completely lost because they went to college that was bought and paid for by some denominational charter of men, and that's what they're teaching. They're teaching what that denominational charter of men wants them to teach, instead of reading the text for themselves, knowing the whole book, putting it all together, asking him for the discernment to understand. They are going to men, and they are anointed by men, just like the Pharisees and the scribes. They were anointed by men. They were not anointed by Yahweh God the Father. So we can know this and we can understand this if we will just pray for the discernment to understand and read the text for what it says. Okay. Lest you be wise in your own sight, I do not want you to be unaware of this mystery, brothers. A partial hardening has come to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And in this way, all Israel will be saved. As it is written, the deliverer will come from Zion. He will banish ungodliness from Jacob. Who's he talking about? He's talking about the Messiah, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. And this will be my covenant with them when I take away their sins. When you are baptized, you are in the grave with the Messiah. Your sins are taken away from you. Your past sins are done. And when you come back up, you are a new creature. And because you understand what the Messiah did, because you understand that God sent his only begotten Son, because you understand that he was beaten, he was humiliated, he was flogged, he was stripped, he was scourged, we understand, we know what sin is. And God's laws are written in our hearts. They are written in our hearts. His commandments, his precepts, his laws, all of it are written in our hearts, just like Jeremiah 31:31 said. He says, I will put my laws in their hearts. How did he do it? He sent his son. He sent his son to do it. No one ever knew. No one ever suspected. No one could have imagined how he was going to do it. How was he going to remarry the divorced nation of Israel in order to bring them back and bring them back to the southern kingdom, the two nations of Israel that had split, to bring them back to be one nation, one olive tree, and that the rest of the world could be grafted into that olive tree. How was all this going to happen? It happened through one man, one God. It happened through the Word, who was made flesh, who came down to walk amongst men. Again, prophesying all about Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. When I take away their sins. He continues on, Romans 11:28. He says, as regards the gospel, they are enemies for your sake. Now he's talking about the Israelites that don't believe, the Jewish, the non-believing Jews. He's telling the Goyim, the Gentile, he's telling them, he said, as regards the gospel, as far as the gospel of Yeshua, okay, he says, the Jews are your enemies, but they're the enemies for your sake, he says. But as regards election, they are beloved for the sake of their forefathers, okay? So right now, the Jews are your enemies because they don't believe in the gospel. But, he says, they are part of the election. They are part of the elect. Because they are beloved for the sake of their forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who we are the offspring of if we have Christ. What does, and I just want to take us over here to, I had some scriptures here that I wanted to kind of really tie this all together with here. And I can't find that scripture. Oh, well, don't worry about that. Let's go to one thing I did want to show you very quickly is I wanted to show you Galatians. For those of you who have not ever read the book of Galatians, we want to get in there very quickly. Let's see here. And I just want to show you this to you. Why is this not going to the thing that I want it to? There we go. Okay. Galatians 3. Okay. Now, is this right? Yes. I went to the right one. Okay. Galatians 3:27. What does Paul say? He says, "For as many of you are baptized into Christ, have put on Christ. Therefore, there is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male, there is no female, for you are all one in Christ." And get this now at the very bottom down here. If you are Christ's, okay, down here at the very bottom, we're at the last sentence at the bottom of the page. "And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to promise." You see, you just can't get out of it, my friends. You cannot get out of it. If you are a Christian, you have been grafted into God's chosen, holy, Israelite people, to the olive tree, to His chosen people, who Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, came out of. It was through His chosen people that the Messiah came. He was a Jew, for Pete's sake. How many people just absolutely don't get that and just want to just tell you anything and everything else about all this dispensational state of grace and all of this garbage and filth and trash and once saved, always saved and all of this other kind of stuff? It's garbage. It's garbage. Don't believe it. Get away from them and rebuke them and rebuke them sharply. Look them right in the face and say, "You liar. You are a liar. There is no such thing as once saved, always saved. And there is no such thing as a Gentile church separate and apart from God's chosen, beloved Israelite people." And we need to stomp that replacement theology doctrine and just throw it to the ground right now and do it sharply. Do it sharply. Okay, very good. Let's continue on here. It says, Romans 11:28, "As regards the gospel, they are enemies for your sake." Those Jews are enemies for your sake. But he says, as regards election, he says, remember now, God loves them and they are beloved for the sake of their forefathers. "For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable." Romans 11:29, for all of you replacement theology cultists out there. "For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable." He called them to be His people. He said, "I will be their God and they will be my people." So we are part of them, or He is not our God and we are not His people. Okay? How hard is that to understand? The gifts of God and the calling of God are irrevocable. He will always find a way to bring His people back. He will always find a way, even though He divorced them and sent them into the four corners of the earth, He'll always find a way because His love is greater than we can even comprehend. We can't even comprehend. And this is, if you ever read the book of Hosea, read the book of Hosea. He told Hosea, marry a prostitute. He told him, "I want you to marry that prostitute because I want you to feel what I'm feeling in my heart, Hosea. I want you to understand." And she did. She left him. She had children by him and everything. They had a family. And she went out and played the whore, just like the Israelites. God wanted Hosea to know. He knew firsthand how God felt. He knew. Read the book of Hosea. It is the greatest love story you'll ever hear. And in the end, Hosea buys, she's nothing but a beaten down slave at that point, at the end. And he walks in, pays a good amount to buy her back. Long story. But again, this is exactly the story of Israel, the Israelites. They were His bride. They have always been His bride. And we are part of that brideship. Or we are outside of the will of God. Okay, we keep sticking our finger in the eye of our brother, the Jewish man, and I'm telling you right now, you're going to lose your salvation. Don't fall for it. Do not fall for what the world is selling you. Do not fall for what these blind guides, these brood of vipers, these whitewashed tombs, these twofold children of hell are teaching you. Don't fall for it. Don't fall for it. It is a lie. And we need to know it, and we need to rebuke it as such, because that's exactly what it is. Okay, very good. So, let's continue on here. It says, so for the gifts of the calling of God are irrevocable. He says, for just as you were at one time disobedient to God, but now have received mercy because of their disobedience, okay? Talking about the Gentile to the Jews because of the Jews or the Israelites' disobedience. He said, so too they have now been disobedient in order that by the mercy shown to you, they may also now receive mercy. Okay? So now because one was sinful, the other one received mercy. And because we were sinful and received mercy, now that's owed to the Jews. Do you see how it's amazing how he binds this all together and tells this secret of God and how God achieved bringing his people back to him once again. Now, I know a lot of people will say, well, you know, this is just absolutely ridiculous and yada, 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 and all this kind of stuff. Let me show you something. And this is something that you need to see. Now, let's go to Exodus 12:48. For those of you who think that God never did care about the Gentiles, you need to know and understand this. Exodus 12:48. What does it say down here? Listen to this now. If a stranger shall sojourn with you. Now, this isn't during the Exodus. This is when God was leading the Israelites away from Pharaoh. Remember, they had to, and Pharaoh chased him into the water and the Red Sea opened up and all this other kind of stuff. That's where this comes from. Many of the Egyptians came with the Israelites. They saw how powerful God was and they wanted to be with the Israelites. They got it. They understood who God was. So what does God say about these sojourners that are coming along with them? What does he say? Let's read Exodus 12:48. He says, if a stranger shall sojourn with you and keep the Passover to the Lord, let all his males be circumcised. Then he may come near and keep it. He shall be as a native of the land. Was he grafting the Gentiles in from the very beginning? You bet he was. Nothing has changed in the eyes of God. He is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. From the very beginning, he was grafting Gentiles in. This is not a new concept. He was already grafting them in. Why did he choose the Israelites to be his people? So that they would be a light on a hill and draw all the other nations to God, to him. Okay? That's exactly what that's what their job was. He always had grafted the Gentiles into the Israelite people. He said, you want to be an Israelite? Come. He says, if a stranger shall sojourn with you and shall keep the Passover to the Lord, let all his males be circumcised, then he may come near and keep it, and he shall be as a native of the land. But no uncircumcised person shall eat of it. There shall be one law for the native and for the stranger that sojourns with you. Is there one law for the Jew and one law for the Gentile, for the Goyim? No. That's not found anywhere in the Word of God. Nowhere. Nowhere is it found that there is one set of laws given to the Jews and one set of laws given to the Gentiles. It's not in there and you can't find it. The reason you can't find it is because it's not in there. Period. Good luck with that. It's not in there. There is one law, and there shall be one law for the native and for the stranger who sojourns among you. Numbers 15:15. Let's go ahead and take a look at Numbers 15:15. I just want you to know this, and I want you to understand these things, because these need to be understood if you're going to understand the 11th chapter of Romans, what Paul's trying to say. What does it say? Numbers 15:14. He says, if a stranger is sojourning with you or anyone is leaving permanently among you, living permanently among you, and he wishes to offer a food offering with a pleasing aroma to the Lord, he shall do as you do. For the assembly, there shall be, listen to this, there shall be one statute for you and for the stranger who sojourns with you, a statute forever throughout your generations. You and the sojourner shall be alike before the Lord. One law and one rule shall be for you and for the stranger who sojourns with you. My friends, do we really believe that God's laws only apply to the Jew only? The Jews were one tribe out of the 12. There were 12 tribes of Israelites that were chosen, that were God's elected people. People will tell you all day long, well, you know, God's laws are all nailed to the cross. Really? Where does it say that? Because you can't find it, and it's not in there. The reason you can't find it is because it's not in there. It's simply not in the Bible anywhere. And you ask a theologian and one of these men with more degrees than a thermometer, exactly and specifically, point out to me where it says that some of God's laws are done away with and some of God's laws are still here, and the laws that were written and were put in the outside of the ark, those laws you don't have to pay attention to, but the laws that were inside the ark, you do have to pay. You do say we're still under. Tell me, where does it say this? Where does it divide up God's laws? Where's the pie in the Bible? Where is it? Because there is none. There is no pie in the Bible. There is no pie. God's laws have never been done away with, my friends. They've never been done away with, ever. Even our Messiah in Matthew 5:17, and if you don't believe anybody else, you got to read what he says. And anyone who says that God's laws are done away with, you will see, is calling our Messiah a liar. They are calling him a liar. Matthew 5:17, I did not come to do away with or to abolish the law. He says very clearly, he says, I did not. Let's go through a few things here. Okay? Let's just go through here very quickly. I just want to touch on some of these things, and I want you to know and understand what's being said here. Okay, let me see if I can get to this here. Okay, Romans. I want to go to Romans 2 and 13. Okay, everybody says it's Paul. Paul did away with the law. Paul did away with the law. What does it say? Romans 2:13. For this is Paul speaking now. Paul, the one who's preaching against God's laws, right? Against God's laws, nailed him to the cross, says Paul, right? This is what Paul says. For it is not the hearers of the law who are righteous before God, but the doers of the law who will be justified. Not the hearers, but the what? The doers. Oh, well, Pastor, don't you know, I'm not saved by works, so that doesn't mean anything for me. Well, I guess not. If you think keeping God's laws is work, I guess you're right. You're outside the will of God. Ding, 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 ding. Are you starting to get the message? Very clearly. If keeping God's laws are work for you, then you are outside the law of God and you do not have the Holy Spirit of God. Period. Okay? Let's just move on here. I just want us to see a few things all through the book of Romans. All through the book of Romans. Here's Romans 2:13. What does Paul say? For it is not the hearers of the law who are righteous before God, but the doers of the law who will be justified. Okay, we've got to understand these things. If we don't understand these things, we're going to absolutely be lost. Absolutely be lost. And we cannot afford that. Romans 8:6. Listen to what Paul says. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Oh, but Paul preached against the laws of God. What does he say right here? For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. How is he preaching against God's law when he's telling us, obviously, right here, to set the mind on the flesh is death, he says. So if you're thinking carnally, and if you think God's laws are done away with, then you are of a carnal mind. You are thinking carnally. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. Why? Because it doesn't submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Now, I don't see how much more simply he could possibly have put it. I just don't understand how it is that we can't understand these things. And that you have these blind guides, these whitewashed tombs, these brood of vipers, these twofold children of hell today telling you and telling me that God's laws are all nailed to the cross. There's a different law for the Jew and for the Gentile. What did God say? There's one law. One law for you and one law for them, and they will be alike before the Lord. You and the sojourner, you Israelite and you sojourner, you'll both be alike before me. That's what the Bible says. Now, I don't know what they're saying, but I know where they're getting their doctrine from, and it's not from this word, and it's not from this book. Let's continue on. What else do we have in here? How about this? For this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and obey His commandments. When we love God and obey His commandments. Oh, Jesus did it all for me. I don't have to do anything. I can go right back to my sin like a dog to his vomit. I can do whatever I want to do. Right? It said, what does it say here? It says, by this we know that we love the children of God. When we love God and obey His commandments, get this, the biblical definition of the love of God, for this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments. And His commandments are not burdensome. They are not work. They are not work for us. Do we get that? Do we understand that? Is this so hard to really understand? How about this one? And by this we know we have come to know Him, if we keep His commandments. Whoever says, I know Him, but does not keep His commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. He's a liar if he doesn't keep His commandments, and the truth isn't even in him. I didn't say that. Word of God says, whoever says, I know Him, doesn't keep His commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps His word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in Him. Whoever says he abides in Him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. What did he say in Matthew 5:17? I didn't come to abolish the laws, I came to fulfill them, to do them. If he did them, we should do them. Hard to understand? Is it really that hard to understand? Because I think not. I think not. We just need to know what in the world the Word of God says and what it doesn't say. How about this one? Here's Matthew 7:21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of God, but the one who does the will of my Father. Listen to this now. It doesn't say the one who does as thou wilt. That's the devil's Bible. Aleister Crowley wrote that. We don't do as thou wilt. What does it say here? Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father, who is in heaven. He's the one that's going to get in. Not the one who's off over here, that crapping all over God's Sabbaths and profaning His name, breaking all of His laws, keeping Easter and Good Friday instead of the Passover, the day that he actually died, keeping the first day of the week Catholic Sunday Sabbath instead of his seventh day Holy Sunday Sabbath, that he said would be a sign between him and his people, a perpetual agreement for all generations. There is no Greek, there is no Jew, there is no Greek, there is no male, there is no female. You are all one in Christ. And if you are one in Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, an Israelite. That's what you are. You can't get out of it, period. So if that applied to the Israelites for all their generations, then it applies to you and me. How are they lying to us and telling us all of this crap, garbage, and nonsense? Once you know the truth, my friends, you have a belly full of anger for what we have been taught for generation upon generation upon generation. How many generations have been lost? My friends, these are the end days we're living in right now here today. And if we can't see the deception, and if we're not praying for the truth of God's word that He would bestow upon us so that we could understand it, we will be lost. Our children and our children and our children's children and our grandchildren will be lost. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. For on that day many will come to me and say, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Haven't we done many miracles in your name? And he's going to say, I don't even know you. I don't even know you. Get away from me, you who are lawless. Get away from me. I don't even know you, and you don't know me. How many people are out there like that right now today? Why? Because they sit in church on the wrong day of the week, listening to some guy they barely know preach out of the back half of the book while programming them not to read the first half of it. And they think they know the book because they read the back half of it. Who reads the back half of a book and says they know the book? Nobody. That's insane. We should know. Who does that? Who goes and buys a book at the bookstore and reads the back half of it and says, I know what happened in the book? Does that even make sense? No. No, it does not make sense. Let's go back to the book of Romans. All right. Very good. I tell you what, I just get on a tirade. And one of the reasons that I'm really so hot about this is this is, again, one of the most important chapters in the book of Romans. And just on my way to work yesterday or the day before, I heard this pastor on the radio preaching that all you have to do is say a prayer and Jesus did it all for you and you can just crap all over him if you want to. Do whatever you want. Do as thou wilt. And that just makes me so mad. It is wrong. It is a lie. And I understand why the Messiah called them, you brood of vipers, you whitewashed tombs, you blind guides. They are blind. They do not know the truth of God's word. And they do not teach the word of God because they do not know it. Let's continue. For just as you were at one time disobedient to God, but now have received mercy because of their disobedience, the Jews, so too they have now been disobedient in order that by the mercy shown to you, they also may now receive mercy. For God has consigned all to disobedience that he may have mercy on all. Do we understand that? He knew we were going to be disobedient. He knew we were imperfect. He's trying to show us how naked, how wretched, how broken down we are, and how much we need the Savior that he sent us. We all need him. The Jews and the Israelites need him to be grafted back in and made one stick to come back to him. And the Gentile, the Goyim, need him so that we can come to him in the first place. And he used us to help each other come together. This is brilliant, absolutely brilliant, when you know to see how the mind of God works in this way. And Paul finishes it off eloquently. He says, oh, the depth of the riches and the wisdom of the and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and how inscrutable his ways. He says, for who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been his counselor? Or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? How could we ever repay him? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. Paul puts it together nicely for us, doesn't he? He really does. And when you know what Paul was actually preaching, and you know what Paul actually said, and you know what Paul was trying to say to those Pharisees, and you know and you understand what he was, how he was trying to meld us all together, you can see in this 11th chapter of Romans how brilliant, absolutely brilliant, our Father in heaven really is. That he achieved all of this before we even knew it. He prophesied even to the Israelites that this was going to happen. And this is why the Messianic Jews are Messianic now. This is why they're coming back to the Messiah. Because they see this, they read this, and they say, oh my God, he was our Messiah. We missed him. And they come back. But you got to get all this Catholicism and all of this Protestantism and all of this modern day Christianity. You got to get it out of the way. You got to flush that down the toilet. this doctrines of demons and man after man after man after man coming and preaching and teaching Christmas and Merry Christmas and Happy Easter and eggs and flying reindeer and divination and all of the things God told us to stay away from. Once you get rid of that, the Jewish man's eyes light up and he gets it. It's like, we've all been lied to. They've lied to the Jew. They've lied to the Gentile. It's a lie. It's a lie. And once you teach a Christian these things, and a Christian knows these things, and he starts using his smartphone, and he starts using his computer for something else besides football statistics and recipes and sitcom, or who's the head of American Idol now, and he starts using it to study the Bible, to know the truth, to look at history, that's when you win people to God. That's when you win people to God. That's how it's done. That's how it's done. Not by sitting in some amphitheater calling people down to the front to say a 60-second prayer with you so that they can be saved. No, my friends. No. No. Do not fall for that deception. It is just astounding to me. Astounding to me what we have fallen for and how it has tripped us up. Our adversary is absolutely brilliant. He is brilliant as well. Let's move on. I just want to move through chapter 12. We can move through this very, very quickly because there's not much to this. It is just basically a continuation, a little bit more simpler. Let's read it. He says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Okay? Oh, there's nothing for you to do, huh? What does this say? What does this say? It says, don't be conformed to the world, but transformed by the renewal of your mind, and test everything, he says, and discern what is the will of God, what is good and what is acceptable and what is perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members, one of another. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them. If prophecy, in proportion to our faith. If service, in our serving. The one who teaches, in his teaching. The one who exhorts, in his exhortation. To the one who contributes, in generosity. The one who leads, with zeal. The one who does acts of mercy, with cheerfulness. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Abhor what is evil. And hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not be slothful in zeal. Be fervent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be consistent in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. Bless those who persecute you and bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, listen to this, if possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all, if possible. Okay? And I want you to really understand this sentence, Romans 12:18. If possible, it's not always possible to live peaceably, is it? If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink, for by doing so you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The writings of the Apostle Paul. I just love the writings of the Apostle Paul. And again, the 11th chapter of Romans is just the heartbeat of the book of Romans. It glues, binds, welds, grafts us all together. We are all one in Christ. We are the offspring of Abraham. We are indeed the offspring of Abraham. Now, I want you to just two more verses that I have here I want to show you. 2 Timothy 3:16. Of course, you probably already know what that is. But let's read it anyway. Let's read it together. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. I want to also turn to Galatians 1:6 very quickly. That was the other one that I chose, Galatians 1:6. Listen to what Paul says in the book of Galatians. He says, I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel. Not that there is one, Paul says, but there are some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one we preach to you, let him be accursed. If anyone, even an angel, comes down, even if we turn around and preach another gospel, let him be accursed, says Paul in the book of Galatians. I want us to know these things, and I want us to understand these things. I want us to study the 11th chapter of the book of Romans. If you don't get anything else in the book of Romans, if you will understand the 11th chapter, you will understand that we are indeed all one people, all underneath the umbrella of God's olive tree, his chosen, begotten people, his people that he says are holy, because the root is holy. And if the root is holy, so are the branches. We need to know these things. We need to understand these things. And as these things begin to grow in us, and as this seed is planted, and as we start realizing that God's Sabbaths are still his Sabbaths, his feast days are still his feast days, his laws are still his laws, his commandments, his precepts, his appointments, his moedim, they apply to both the Jew and the goyim, the Gentile. Both for the Israelite and the sojourner, there shall be one law, not two, one. My friends, I hope and I pray that this particular teaching has been a blessing to you and to your family. I know that if you are still with me here after all of that, you have a thirst for knowledge. God bless you. Thank you so very much for staying with me here. Again, I'm Pastor Scott Blaine with Holy Impact Ministries. .com. And you can visit us at holyimpactministries.com. It's open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. You can go there anytime you like. You can also email me at pastorv@holyimpactministries.com. This particular teaching is free to everyone, and it is meant to be freely given. So please download it, share it, take it to Bible studies, use it as a guideline for your own Bible studies, in your own Bible teachings, but please do not sell the video. That's all that we ask. It is free, and we are glad to offer it to you. In the meantime, it is my prayer that the grace and the peace of God would be with you and with your family, as well as the hand of God upon you and your family, and his protection until we meet again. We hope to see you this next seven-day Sabbath, as we do our live Seventh-day Sabbath event, which is Friday nights at 9 o'clock. And all you have to do is go to holyimpactministries.com. We've got a little tab right there that says click right here to join us, and you can join us live Friday night at 9 o'clock for our Holy Impact Ministries Seventh-day Sabbath gathering. And we will talk more then. If not, we will see you next Wednesday night at 8 o'clock as we move into the 13th chapter of the book of Romans. I want to say thank you one more time to everybody who stuck it out with us and who has gone through this teaching with us. We hope that it's been a blessing to you. God bless you, and shalom.
If you were blessed by this teaching, please consider helping us reach the nations by making a donation today. Thank you, and shalom.